Good afternoon. Everybody had lunch? What did you have for lunch? Dosa with chutney and a side helping of coronavirus. No? That was not on the menu. Okay, so one important topic that I skipped, so I want to cover that thing. Yeah, are there any questions about anything that we have talked about so far? That seat is still broken. Alright then, so the topic that I want to talk about today is the electric field, the field due to a moving point charge. Okay? And this is an important topic for many obvious reasons, right? Corona says, okay? I think it helps for the audio also. So obviously the field of a moving point charge is an important topic, right? Because when you want to talk about high energy scattering, right? You cannot ignore relativistic effects, right? And so it's clear that the electric field, first thing is that a moving point charge will create a magnetic field also. So we should understand what is the magnetic field that is generated, and also what happens to the electric field, right? How does the electric field transform? Now, in previous classes we worked out that the transformation of the electric field. Everybody remember what is the transformation? What happens to the parallel component? Parallel component remains the same. Perpendicular component? Dilated, right? Increased by a factor of gamma. Plus some contribution from the magnetic field if there is a magnetic field. Okay. Now in this case, we are going to start with a charge at rest in our frame of reference. Okay. And what is the electric field due to this charge? Everybody knows what there is. 4 pi epsilon naught r cubed. So we place it at the origin. R cubed divided by or multiplied by vector. Right? So, the transformation of the electric and magnetic fields, let's apply that, okay, and see what happens. Now, so we have an observer, let's say, S prime. With respect to S prime, S is moving with some velocity v as usual in the x direction. Okay. So now what is the transformation law for the electric field? Let's write that down. E parallel prime is equal to E parallel and E perpendicular prime is equal to gamma E perpendicular plus E cross B. So this B cross B, when you have this, when we have this setup, B cross B is in this direction. So taking the cross product of B, it will give me the component of B perpendicular to the velocity vector, right? So I can write B cross B as B, B perpendicular component. Right? You have A cross B. What is this? This is equal to vector A, magnitude of this vector A times the B and then sine theta. Now you can think of B sine theta as B perpendicular. It's the component of B, right? This is A, this is B, this is theta. So this is B sine theta and this is B perpendicular. I can also write this as B perpendicular. This is just to show you that the transverse components are transformed amongst each other. Right? There is no role played by the parallel component. Okay? So now, using this, using the first line, E parallel prime equal to E prime. So this becomes equal to, so the field in the parallel direction. So this is x, this is x prime. So it is q times x prime over 4 pi epsilon naught r prime q. Right? So it's the x component, the x prime, the prime there, somewhere, wherever you want. Okay, now what about Ey and Ez? So they will become this factor of gamma, right? So Ey prime, there is no magnetic field, right? Ey prime is going to be equal to gamma Ey and Ez prime is equal to gamma. Okay, so there should be no prime here. This is your x. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to determine the electric field as seen by the prime coordinate system. This tells us, this relationship tells us that the prime electric field is the same as the unprimed one in the parallel direction. Right? So we know that in the parallel direction, the electric field is written as in terms of qx, what that's called r prime, sorry, r q. Okay? So, we don't yet know what form this expression takes in the prime coordinates. I hope you follow this. It's a little bit of a circuit. Okay? So, Ey, what is Ey again? Gamma q y over 4 pi epsilon naught r cube, and this becomes gamma q z 4 pi epsilon naught r cube. Okay? So this is the electric field seen in the frame S prime. Is it?
Right. But S is moving with velocity.
the point you so a statement that S prime is at rest, is that statement correct? What would be the correct statement? Greater is equal to what? The correct statement is that S is moving in the x direction with the speed v with respect to S. And S prime is moving with the speed minus v with respect to S. Right? So you can work in either frame of reference. Now, I want to see what the electric field of a moving charge looks like, right? So, the charge is moving in my frame of reference. So, my frame of reference is this prime frame, right? Which is the lap frame, let's say. And this is the rest frame of the particle, right? So, in the rest frame of the particle, the electric field is given by this expression, right? This same electric field as seen by me in the lab frame, how do I convert it? I use the Lorentz transformation, right? We have derived this. So we get that the prime component, the parallel component is the same. Now the parallel component of the electric field in the prime frame, that is in the lab frame as seen by me, right? So how should I write it? I can't write it as what I had done previously, right? That was a mistake. So I can't write it like this. I can't do that, right? It is equal to E parallel, and I know that E parallel is equal to this expression. This is what I know, right? Now these coordinates x and r are in the charge particles rest frame, right? So to find the full expression for the electric field in my frame of reference, what do I have to do? I have to take these coordinates x, y, z and apply the Lorentz transformation to them to get the prime coordinates. So this equality tells me that the electric field in the parallel direction is given by this expression. Now, in the prime coordinates, what is x and what is r? So r square is equal to x square plus y square plus gamma square. Okay. I want to write this expression in terms of x prime, y prime and z prime. Now y prime and z prime will be the same, right? What will be x in terms of x prime, right? So I'm measuring the electric field, let's say at some in the rest frame of the charge, the electric field is being measured at some point, right? As seen by me, the same point is, this is x prime, this is x, right? So what is the relationship between x and x prime? X is equal to gamma x prime. Think about this for 1 second, okay? Right? Imagine there is a rod connecting the charge particle to this point, okay? What is the length of this rod? X, right? Now at the time we do this Lorentz transformation, let's assume that the origin of my frames of reference is the same. Okay? So this end of the rod is at the origin of this frame of reference also. Now what is the length of this rod as seen by this length? It is x divided by gamma, Lorentz contraction. So what is the coordinate location of this point as seen by me? It's x divided by gamma, right? So x is equal to gamma h. Okay? If you do it naively, you would do the opposite, right? So x is equal to gamma x prime. Okay? Akshay is still processing. And so in the lab frame, r square becomes gamma x prime squared plus y squared, y prime squared plus z prime squared. Okay? These fields again, but now this time in the prime quadrants. So in the prime quadrants, I have Ex prime, which is equal to E parallel prime, is equal to gamma Q X prime divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. And r prime cube, where r prime is equal to or I have to sleeve it in this way, gamma square x prime square plus y square plus z square to the power 3 halves. Okay, e y prime. Same thing, gamma factor from top, cube, y over 4 pi epsilon naught, and then the same factor, and e z prime is equal to gamma cube z 4 pi epsilon naught. Okay? So, if we are not careful about how we, about the coordinates, about which coordinate is corresponds to which coordinate and which frame of reference, then your default reaction would be to say that Ex prime will be equal to kq x prime over r prime cube. This would be what you would say. You would say, okay, well, it's just equal to the parallel component, right? But you are forgetting the Lorentz transformation. Once you include the Lorentz transformation, you get this factor of gamma here and okay? In the case of, see, because the Lorentz transformation acts on the electric fields, but it also acts on the coordinates. In this case, the electric field is a function of the coordinates. Okay? Now, the transformation law of the electric and magnetic fields, when we worked it out, we didn't make any assumptions about whether the electric and magnetic fields are constant or varying. Right? We simply said that there is a certain object which is, we call this the Maxwell tensor, okay? And we said that it has these components. Uh, you should all know this by heart. If you forget how to, the way I do it is I just, each time I write this down, I work up the components. Okay? So this is the diagonal components are 0. This becomes xy. Right? First row, second column. That's the xy coordinate, xy component. That corresponds to bz. This is the xz component. Right? So that will be minus by because of the circular permutation. Right? xyz, zx, y, yzx. Right? So, if I want to look at this in the new frame of reference, what do? I apply the Lorentz transformation twice, once for each index. So I can write this as lambda f lambda transpose. Okay. In case you are more familiar, more comfortable with that notation, right? You can always do that. So when you do this transformation, and I think I gave this transformation to you as a problem before the mixer, right? You get exactly this relationship for Ex, Ey, and you find that Ex will not change. Right? Assuming you take lambda to be our standard gamma, minus beta gamma, everything else 1, 1 and then 2. In that case, you will get exactly the same expression. Nowhere does this make any assumption that these components are some, either they are constants or not. The only fact that we are using is that this is a tensor, and so it should transform in a certain way under Lorentz transformation, right? So this tensor is telling me that E prime is equal to E parallel, right? But E parallel prime is defined as a function of the unprime spatial coordinates. Right? So the functional form of E prime parallel is equal to this. Right? Now, if I want to express this in terms, I have to express this in terms of the prime coordinates. So I have to apply the Lorentz transformation to these coordinates, right? That will change the final functional form. It will give me this gamma factor here and here. Same thing, the perpendicular component picks up a factor of gamma, right? Where does this come from? It comes from the covariance of the Maxwell tensor, okay? But again, it's gamma times E perpendicular in which coordinates? X, Y, Z coordinates. So I multiply it by gamma, that gives me this factor, right? But then again, the xyz components, when I transform to x prime, y prime, z prime, I get this gamma factor in the denominator. Okay? So the final expression for the electric field of a moving point charge can be written as E prime gamma q. So this I should write as primes. Gamma q r prime divided by, I'll just put k here instead of 4 by epsilon naught, the gamma square x prime square y prime square z prime square to the power 3 plus. Okay? This is a single vectorial identity, right? happens to this field in the transverse direction, okay, at x is equal to 0. So at x is equal to 0, and please also keep in mind that in doing this Lorentz transformation, I have set time in t is equal to 0. Otherwise, here I would also get a factor of beta gamma c p. Right? So, in the transverse direction, that is at x prime equal to 0, right? I have my expression is just y squared plus z squared. Right? And this is also the same r prime, the length of this r prime is the same as r because lengths in this direction are not affected. So the electric field component in this direction is amplified by a factor of gamma, right? Compared to, so this I write as e prime compared to gamma prime. Okay. What about the electric field at a point on the x-axis? Right? Now, what happens? Y and Z, Y prime, Z prime, 0. Here you have gamma X, and here you have gamma cube, X cube, prime cube. So you get a factor of 1 by gamma squared. Right? So the field in this direction is contracted by a factor of 1 by gamma squared. Okay? So the field lines look squeezed in the longitudinal direction and stretched in the transverse
direction.
Okay?
But for the observer, if the particle will look the same? For the observer that is moving along the particle will look the same.
The what will look the same?
The field lines of the.
No, of course not.
For the, that observer to
increase. For which observer?
The observer is moving with the velocity V. Like, not the lamp, with the
particle. So the observer is the rest frame of this.
Particle.
Of this thing, huh? No, so for that, you are in the rest frame, you will just see the infinite electric.
Yeah, so it won't be quadratic.
Huh?
So it won't be quadratic. No.
You are in the rest frame. Okay? But you are moving one chart, right?
Along the direction.
Along the direction of? So in this case, in the x direction. But there is a way to write this so that the expression becomes general. So let me see. Tell you that expression. Okay? The expression looks something like this. If you do it if you want to do it in a way that doesn't depend on x, y, and z, you get e prime equal to something like this: gamma k gamma q, then r prime by r prime q times 1 minus something like this, 1 half b squared. Sine squared theta, where theta is the, so v is the direction of motion of the charge, and theta is the angle between r prime, the point at which you are measuring the field, and the direction of motion. So this doesn't make any reference to whether you're moving the x axis or y axis. Also, I wanted to mention that there is another nice reference for electromagnetic Curie. So these are lectures by David Thom. Okay? You can find them on his website. David Thom has lectures on everything. Okay? If you just sit at the feet of David Thom and study all his lectures, you will attain enlightenment. So, so this is the electric field. Now the question is, what is the magnetic field? Right? So again, let's see, the magnetic field in the parallel direction is unchanged. The magnetic field in the perpendicular direction becomes gamma B perpendicular minus B cross E. So that becomes B times E perpendicular divided by C square. Then again E perpendicular, so it's the component of E perpendicular to the velocity. Right? Now this is zero because in the rest frame of the charge there are no magnetic fields. Right? So what is this perpendicular component look like? It looks like minus B by C squared. So what will be the direction of this magnetic field? It will be the same as the one given by the right hand rule. Right? B is in this direction, E is in this direction, right? The perpendicular component. So when you make B cross E, like this, B cross E, you will get a magnetic field over here pointing out of the page, over here going into the page, right? So everywhere it will have a cylindrical symmetry around the directional motion. But it's not a constant because this E perpendicular depends on position, right? So what is this E perpendicular? So there's also a factor of gamma, and then E perpendicular becomes KQ over this thing. R cubed becomes again gamma squared, x prime squared, y prime squared, z prime squared, 3/2. And then here you can write R prime perpendicular. Or if you want, I'll just leave it as R squared. I'll just keep it. This is the magnitude of this magnetic field. The direction, you know, is like this. So what is it? What does it look like at points which lie on the y prime axis and in the z prime axis? So in the y prime, z prime plane. In that plane, x prime is 0. Right? So this magnetic field is dilated by a factor of gamma. Okay? So dilated means increased. Okay?
It should be gamma squared, right?
Huh?
Perpendicular component is dilated by gamma. Perpendicular component of y, sorry, E.
Where should the gamma squared be?
Means E perpendicular already has a gamma outside. E perpendicular again has a gamma.
No. This is gamma B E perpendicular.
Oh, that's
not E perpendicular prime. Okay. So, this is my point charge. The magnetic field in the plane which contains the point charge and is normal to the direction of motion, the magnetic field has the same circular symmetry, but it is just So what would it normally be? The magnetic field would be mu naught I by 2R, and probably related to this, by converting the charge into the current in some way. So in this case, it's just increased by a factor of gamma. What happens at points either in front of the charge or behind the charge? Well, at those points, you will get a factor of gamma on top, but you also get a factor of 1 by gamma squared in the denominator, right? So the electric field as you go, magnetic fields as you go in this direction, will shrink. In the back, right? So they will form some sort of a envelope like this. Question? So steam has a better picture than I can draw. Only 5 pairs of chuckles for 100 rupees. Going fast, going fast. This is how they sell on game.
This is in the YZ plane.
It's always in the YZ plane, right? Because here B parallel is 0. So B parallel prime is also going to be 0. So the magnetic field, as for the electric field, I think I made a small mistake. It will be dilated by a factor in gamma in the transverse direction, and by a factor of 1 by gamma. So I got some of the factors wrong. Will it be?
It is.
You work it out as well. Okay? Leave it as a comment in the
YouTube. 11 R'
Then I will leave.
11 R' in the numerator already.
So sorry?
We have an R' in the numerator already.
We have an R'
in the numerator.
It's not clear to me at all what he said. Yes, brother, can you translate?
Yeah, he said that there's an R prime already in the numerator.
Yeah. So there's an R prime cube, right?
And there's a gamma already.
So, I don't know, you work out the dependence. Today is one of those days when I'm actually feeling hungry. Normally, on those days when I don't feel hungry, I have greater enthusiasm. You all have food, right? My food arrives, it's delivered, and it arrives 10 minutes by 1:30. So at 1:30 we have class. Obviously, I can't suspend class and ask you all to sit and wait there while I eat my chapatis here. Right? It may exciting be a movie minute because interval is taking it long and come back. Okay? So, then there are various other problems that one can look at. Okay? One can look at the electric field of a line of charge, right? One can consider also any configuration, cylindrical, sphere, ask what happens to the electric field of a sphere, for example, of a spherical distribution of charge. Maybe I'll give you some of these problems in the second week. So Since you know the general principle, you should be able to work it out. Right? Don't worry, I won't be so close. Okay? So, now we have covered this paradigm answer. I've introduced the paradigm to you, or Maxwell paradigm answer, which is this object. And we have also what happens to the equation of electromagnetism when written in terms of the gauge potentials. So in terms of the gauge potentials, we have a 4-vector. Okay? And all of these results, everything that we have worked out, like the electric and magnetic field of a point charge, or the general transformation rule, you can get that by, as I said, mentioned in the last lecture, by looking at the way this guy transforms. Right? This is a 4-vector. So in my new frame, I get a different 4-vector. Right? So if for simplicity I say there is only an x component and there is no y component or z component, these are 0, then in my new frame of reference, moving frame or rest frame, whichever it is, what is this? This is gamma phi phi c minus beta gamma. This is the t component, so the t component goes as right. Gamma phi by c minus eta ax, and ax prime gamma times ax minus eta phi x. So these are your transformed gauge potentials. In terms of these gauge potentials, you can calculate. So you don't have to set these to 0. You can let them be non-zero, because under the Lorentz transformation, these are the transverse components of this 4-vector, they will be unaffected, right? It's a 4-vector, so the transverse components are not affected by the Lorentz transformation, right? So, you have your new set of potentials. In terms of these, you can now work out what the electric and magnetic fields are, E prime and B prime. B prime is the curl of this spatial A prime, and E prime is the minus gradient of phi prime minus d by dt of A prime. But you have to be careful again, because when you take the gradient and the curl and the time derivative, you have to take those with respect to the prime coordinates. So there is a little bit more algebra there. Once you work it all out, right, you get these expressions for the transverse components and parallel components. Okay. And then we have Maxwell's equations. So Maxwell's equations can be written. What happens to Maxwell's equations? We can work in different choices of gauge, right? So, as I mentioned initially, gauge means, what is to gauge something means to measure something. So choice of gauge means that you are fixing some reference frame with respect to which you are measuring quantities. Okay. So for instance, when you say that, you know, I want to measure distances. Now, to measure distances, how? In some unit, right? You have some unit of distance and you measure any interval as being some multiple of this unit. Right? Now, you can always choose a different unit. Right? You can have a larger unit or a smaller unit. Your distances will change, right? This is the gauge. This is the gauge, the unit that we are using to make the measurements. Okay. This actually has a in terms of this gauge field description, this distance gauge can also be written as a gauge field. In fact, this was one of the first gauge fields to be written down by Hermann Weyl. And so what is the idea? The idea is that, see what happens in general relativity, for example, okay? That you have varying electromagnetic, varying space-time metric, right? So as the space-time metric changes from point to point, the speed of clocks, right, changes from point to point. So if you can measure how the speed of a clock is changing from one point to the next point, right? That tells you, so how do you measure that change? You measure that change in terms of a gauge potential. So the gauge tells you, my clock is running at a certain speed. My gauge potential tells me, if I go in this direction, whether it will slow up or speed down, slow down or speed up. So if I know the gauge potential at all points, right, then I can give a complete description of the gravitational field, right? Now not only time intervals but distance intervals are also changed, right, because the metric measures distances in space and time, right? So I have to measure time intervals also, and I have to measure spatial volume also. If I can measure both of these things and say how they change from point to point, that information will tell me the complete configuration of the gravitational field. Now, this is okay. So you can, like I said, so now it's not so obvious what this electromagnetic gauge is doing, right? So I'll give you another example of a gauge field, just to help you understand the concept a little bit with a little bit more clarity. Imagine that you have a system of spins. Okay? So you have, it can be one dimensional, it can be any Now, dimensionality you want it to be, okay? 1, 2, 3. So, let's say that we have some system of strains in two dimensions. Okay? And these strains can take any value, they can point in any direction. Okay? Not just up and down. So, I can have some arbitrary configuration of strings. So, at each point, what do? I have a unit vector which is giving me the direction in which that spin is pointing at that point, right? Okay? So now when I go from one point to another point, when I go from here to here, right? The spin is changing, right? Here it points in one direction, let's say N, and let me call this lattice rotation I, let me call this J. So here the spin vector is Ni, here the spin vector is Nj, right? Now these are both Ni and Nj. These are both unit vectors which represent directions, right? So in order to go from one direction to another direction, what do I have to do? What sort of transformation is involved? A rotation, right? So as I go from here to here, right? So you imagine that the direction of the spin tells you the direction of what is up locally. So when you go here, your direction of up changes, it becomes in this direction. How do you measure this change? Right? There is some matrix R, right? Some SO3 matrix. SO3 is a, right? So it's a 3x3 orthogonal matrix with unit determinant, right? So R, there is some matrix R which, if you take R and multiply it with the vector N, I, you will get N, J, right? Okay? So there is some, you can connect these two with this R, I, J, let's say, okay? From J to K, there will be some other matrix. And if you have, your system is spread out in more than one dimension, then if you go in one dimension, in a certain direction, you will have some matrix. If you go in this direction, you will have something in this direction. Right? Okay? This matrix, right? So what am I doing? At each or in the neighborhood of each point, right? So I am not associating these matrices with individual points but with intervals between points, right? So I can take the midpoint between each lattice rotation, right? Let me do this a little bit more nicely. So this is I, J, A. From here to here is the matrix I, R, I, J. From here to here is the matrix R, J. Okay? So this R, I, J, I can associate with this midpoint. Okay? These midpoints form another lattice, right? So what am I doing? Now I have a lattice. At each point of the lattice, I am putting a group element. Okay? This is an example of a gauge field, a local gauge field. Okay? Why is it a gauge field? Because these matrices are not uniquely determined. Right? The matrix depends on what our global definition of up and down is. Right? So I have some global definition of up and down. Right? Some global definition of XYZ. I have some frame in my laboratory, right? It is with respect to this frame that I measure the orientation of the spin, right? Yes? What happens if I change my frame? If I rotate my frame by some super, by, so how will I rotate it? I will rotate it by applying another SOC matrix. But if I rotate my frame R by this matrix R, so let me call it bold R, then what will happen to these individual matrices? They will all be rotated by this R, right? So there is a freedom in the definition of these matrices, right? They are not uniquely defined. Okay? We will see that this gauge field also measures the change in the electromagnetic field from point to point. And it is also not uniquely defined. Right? So I did think of some simpler examples of gauge fields, but for some reason.
So
forget this.
So is this gauge field dependent on global transmission?
Huh?
Is this gauge field?
Yeah, I don't want to like go into that discussion of global and local gauge field right now. I think this is enough. But yeah, this is a global gauge transportation. Because I'm rotating everything by the same element. Yeah. But I don't want to introduce the local idea right now because this is enough. Alright. Any questions? Any other questions?